Again, thank you for the invitation to come and testify today. It's, I think, an important thing that the commission does in its oversight role, not just on this issue, but on so many other human rights problems that face our country and the world. And I think that as President Obama has recently made very clear, we in the Obama administration consider this to be one of the core human rights violations that we must confront. And we don't use that term lightly. We don't bandy it about willy-nilly. We think that this is a crime, it's a development issue, and at the end of the day, it is a human rights crime. The man whose life and work inspired this commission, Congressman Lantos, embodied the American spirit in fighting against modern slavery as himself a victim and a survivor of forced labor, factory work at the hands of the Nazis, but also the work that he did then to understand and confront this crime around the world. And it's in that spirit, especially, that it's an honor to work with the commission to carry out Tom Lantos's work of advancing human rights and the cause of free and fair labor. Let me say more generally what a pleasure it's been over the last 4 years advancing our work on human trafficking issue with colleagues across government, whether the counterparts at partner agencies or supporters of our efforts on Capitol Hill. And since the start of the modern anti-trafficking movement more than a decade ago, we've seen consistent bipartisan support. I'm happy to say that we've built on that tradition in recent years. This issue continues to garner focus from the highest levels of government, just as President Clinton made his mark by signing the Trafficking Victims Protection Act in 2000, as President Bush carried that momentum forward. President Obama has made that fight against human trafficking a priority for his White House. As we heard in his speech at the Clinton Global Initiative meeting in September, he's committed to in the fight against modern slavery, whether trafficking for commercial sex exploitation or, as we're discussing today, forced labor. Commitment, however, is not enough. It takes action. It takes results. And so what are we doing in the Obama administration? We're pressing ahead with practices that have shown the best results, ramping up victim identification efforts, seeing the prosecution of more traffickers here at home and around the world. We're providing services to survivors and working to train law enforcement and justice officials around the world. We're keeping track of this problem and how well the governments are fighting it through the annual Trafficking in Persons report, and we appreciate your kind words, but also the challenge to continue to improve and engage through the report. The State Department works with our partner agencies across the USG to make sure that people who travel to this country on non-immigrant visas are aware of their rights. We've made our reporting standards sharper and more specific. We've enhanced protections for immigrant victims who are resettled in the home countries. Our partner agencies have established programs for unaccompanied alien children, implemented new family unification measures, and are incorporating trafficking offenses in the Unified Crime Reporting Statistics, all of which were tasked for us during the last authorization in 2008. And we certainly share your concern that Congress to date has not been able to reauthorize that legislation. Regardless of whether we have authorizing legislation or not, though, we will continue this work and we will continue to implement this law as it has been passed on the bipartisan level 4 times in the last 12 years. When we look at the scale of the problem, and it ranges from that ILO estimate of 21 million people to the higher ends, 27, maybe even 28, depending on some of the different researchers out there, we realize that the future of the struggle depends on new innovations and fresh approaches. So we're also focused on developing those new ideas for dealing with this crime, addressing a culture that addresses modern slavery as just somebody else's problem, or a mentality that boys will be boys, or that the low cost of a product comes somehow at no cost to the worker. Those are all cultural assumptions as much as they are governing and political assumptions, and we have to confront that at the same time as we confront what government can and must do. When it comes to forced labor, we're not just looking at governments. We're looking at the supply chains and labor sources behind the products that we use every day. And what we've found, whether it's through our work with the business coalitions, working with the workers' rights groups, the research done by slaveryfootprint.org and others, should make us all think about the way that this crime affects our lives. Because it's likely that many of the products that we use and rely on every day, from our coffee this morning to our cotton sheets and shirts, to the smartphone in our pocket, to the car we drove to work, were somehow touched by forced labor along the line. We need to keep prosecuting traffickers and protecting their victims. But if that's all we do, it means we're just cleaning up the mess after the abuse and exploitation has occurred. And so stopping this problem in the supply chain will require greater awareness by consumers and new partnerships with the private sector, corporate leaders who are committed to making sure that their goods and services are free from exploitation. We're making the case that fighting slavery is good business. Just as Harvard Business School showed that American consumers are willing to pay a price premium if they know that what they're buying hasn't been tainted by modern slavery. And we're helping develop code of conduct, monitoring standards, et cetera, that allow businesses to make the fight against slavery part of their corporate policies. Being a lawyer, I certainly have a soft spot for the centrality of lawyers in most processes. And by working with the American Bar Association, not just the criminal law section of the American Bar Association, but the business law section of the American Bar Association, we're harnessing the power of attorneys across the government to be able to, across the government and across the business community, so they can advise their clients. It's not just the prosecutors that need to learn how to deal with human trafficking, it's corporate counsel as well. Having described this out in the private sector, it's important then to turn back inwards. We believe that we need to lead by example. The U.S. government is one of the largest purchasers in the world, and if we're going to tell companies and consumers that they need to care about modern slavery, we're going to have to hold ourselves to the same standard. That's why the president signed the executive order that you mentioned that provides more extensive prohibitions and protections for U.S. government purchases to make sure that our tax dollars, your tax dollars, are not being used to support human trafficking. In effect, it tells companies, if you want to do business with us, modern slavery is a problem that you need to confront as well. These are important steps, but they're only a start. And if we continue to support this effort with the resources, with the support it needs, we'll be able to enlist more partners in the struggle, develop new tools for fighting the crime, and move closer to the world that we want to live in, a world free from slavery. Thank you again, Chairman, for your invitation to testify today, for your support throughout the years, and for the work that you and others on the Lantos Commission are doing as our partners in this most American fight, the fight for freedom.